It's August the 23rd, 1998. The survivor is Kurt Landskroner. Last name at birth was Landskroner. The interviewer is Bernice Krantz. We are in Horsham, West Sussex in the UK, and the language is English. It's August the 23rd, 1998. My name is Bernice Krantz. I'm conducting an interview with Kurt Landskroner, and we are in Horsham, West Sussex in the United Kingdom. Okay. Please, can you give me your name and spell it?
My name is Kurt Landskroner. The spelling is K-U-R-T-L-A-N-D-S-K-R-O-N-E-R.
And what was your name at birth?
The same. My name at birth was the same.
Please, can you give me your date of birth?
My date of birth is the 18th of December, 1927.
And your age now?
Nearly 71.
And where were you born?
I was born in Graz, Austria. Annenstrasse 36 is the exact address.
Right. If we could start by talking about your sort of earliest childhood memories.
Yes. I lived in a house which was owned by my grandfather. It was a block of flats. And we lived on the first floor, and my grandfather lived on the third floor. We had a huge garden, and I have very happy memories of my early childhood. School was pleasant, and I had friends and family around me, and I really was quite a happy child.
Just going back to your grandfather, what was his name?
My grandfather was Ernst Clementschitz. And my grandmother was Crystal Clementschitz. They were both politically involved very much in life. I was aware of that as a child, although I didn't know what it was really about. And they were both of political opinions, very strong ones, and fought for the workers' movement in Austria against the government. My grandfather was a socialist, and my grandmother was a communist.
What sort of work did he do?
My grandfather had a shop, a large shop in Graz, and my mother was employed in the shop also. My grandmother worked mainly in a political field, you know.
What about the other set of grandparents? What were their names?
Well, I'm not sure of their names, but my father, Elias Landskroner, came from Sereth in Romania. And he met my mother because he worked in my grandfather's shop. My father was Jewish. My mother was Roman Catholic. But they married, and she became of the Jewish faith. So as a child, I remember going to the synagogue weekly. And I was brought up as a Jewish child, as was my sister Lottie.
Were you older than your sister?
I was 2 years older than my sister, yes. Lotte was also happy at that stage of her life. And really, we had a happy childhood until March the 30th, when the Anschluss came. And I remember distinctly that the day after, or 2 days after, the boys in school locked me up in the cupboards where the coats were hanging. And finally, I was expelled from school. Also, we were not allowed to use public transport as Jews. And to my big dismay, because it was summer, I wasn't allowed to use the swimming pool, which was a disaster for me.
How old were you at that point?
I was 11 years old, and my sister 9. At that stage, my mother then was already making moves to try and get the children, Lottie and myself, out to another country, the USA, South America, England. And she was in touch with families in various parts of the world. We eventually got a letter from a family in West Kirby, the Pinkerton family, who said they would would care for me. And they had another family in the same village. Who would take care of my sister.
Right, just before we get on to that, if we could sort of go back a little bit. You know, a little bit more about school. Do you remember actually starting school?
I don't really remember very much about school in the early days. I remember that I had to walk to school and it was along the river. And I looked at some of my reports. They weren't particularly good, but that's really all I can remember of my school days.
Were you interested in anything in particular as a young boy?
My main interest, really, in sport, on the sports side, was swimming. I wasn't a sort of football person. I was really interested in swimming. My other interests were partly in the garden, because my grandfather had this very, very big garden. And that's about it at that stage, really. So it wasn't, as I told you, it was the Anschluss that got us out of school. And it was after that our lives completely changed, because we were then Jewish refugees. We were of unclean blood, because my father was Jewish. But my mother was told that if she said that she was an Aryan and that she'd been raped by a Jew, then she would get an Arnhem Pass. And the Arnhem Pass meant you were a pure Aryan. And she, in fact, obtained an Arnhem Pass. So it meant that she wasn't troubled by the authorities. And if we go on a little bit further to the Kristallnacht, which was the first real tragic moment in my life that I remember, we knew that a German diplomat had been shot by a Polish student in Paris because his parents had been deported. All Polish Jews were deported from France. And as a revenge, he shot this diplomat. And everybody knew the Nazis were going to take revenge. And this revenge took place in what was later called the Kristallnacht, which means the smashing up of glasses. Also, all synagogues were burned, and many, many people were sent to concentration camps. In our case, my mother already had taken precautions, and Lottie and myself were sleeping upstairs in the third floor flat with my grandparents. On the actual Kristallnacht, which was the 9th of November, 1938, my mother heard shouting and noises, and she said to my father, "We must go upstairs." And he was half asleep, and he said, "Oh, don't be silly, everything's all right." She ran upstairs and came to us. My father went back to sleep, and it was only when the front door was broken in, he realized there were problems. And he ran, as we lived on the first floor, he ran across the roof of the shop, down into the garden, and down the street to the nearest police station. The officer in charge of the police station was a great friend of my father's, whom they used to play coffee and play cards in the cafe house. Turned him away. He said, "I can't help you. You can't come in here." So he wandered round the streets, sticking into the shadows, until he was finally caught by a group of youths, Gestapo, and he was beaten, and he was beaten very, very badly. Beaten round the head, and was left unconscious. When he recovered consciousness, he managed to get home. I remember so distinctly coming down the stairs. My mother had arranged, our flat was completely destroyed. All our furniture, my mother's lovely glass cabinet, which had beautiful, in Austria in those days, wedding presents were red and green glasses, and I always admired these glasses. Everything was smashed. We have a crystal glass that's left, and a silver dented bowl. That's really what was left of our home. But as I said, my father was lying on a mattress because the beds were also smashed. His head was covered in blood. The mattress was covered in blood. And it was at that stage, we were down there with him when the SA came, and knocked on the door next door on the other downstairs flat, where there was a very kindly old man called Mr. Stern, lived there, a Jew, had a sweet shop down in the Annenstrasse, and they took him away. And then they came into our house, our flat, and they took one look at my father and left him. And that was his savior at that time. Because shortly after that, we managed to get him away on the underground to Israel, where he had to swim ashore, because in those days the British troops were preventing Jews from landing in Israel. He lived for 2 or 3 years, but then died of a brain tumor, which was obviously due to the beatings he'd had about the head. So I never saw my father again. I was sorry that, you know, my last memories of him basically were in this bed, and then shortly afterwards he disappeared.
Do you know how your mother arranged for him to go off to Israel?
No, I don't. And unfortunately, my mother is 89 years old now, and her memory is gone. I wished I'd documented more of these facts earlier in life, but I'm glad to have the opportunity to do this now. So it was a traumatic time.
What happened to you after your father left for Israel?
Well, we were still waiting to get confirmation that we were allowed to go to England. And this finally came in the January of 1939. And we went on a Red Cross train, which was Kinder Transport, as it was called in those days, and had a long, long, to us children, a long, long train journey to Victoria Station. My sister was always travel sick, so I had to look after her, which was quite a task. We arrived in Victoria Station, and there were all these kindly women rushing around with armbands on, putting children into lines, because most of the children were going into a camp of some sort of holding camp, etc. I knew that we were not to go, though. We were being collected. And we escaped from these lines, but we were twice pushed back. I remember this is one of the main memories of this time. And we finally managed it, and we sat at the end of the platform on our suitcases, and I sat there wondering, had I done the right thing? Well, a few minutes later, a lady came along with a picture, and it was Mrs. Allen, and she said, "Are you Courtney Lorna?" And we said, "Yes," and to my relief, we were at last being picked up.
If I could just take you back again, can you describe what it was like getting ready to leave for your journey?
Well, I can only remember fragments, really, but I remember the packing, my mother obviously doing the packing and giving us instructions. We had to, first of all, get from Graz to Vienna. Now, I'd never been to Vienna, and we were in a huge building in Vienna, being herded around, getting all the papers stamped that would allow us to go. There is a little story that my mother told me before that. The train from Graz to Vienna, in those days, there were so many Jewish people trying to get out that some Jews were actually bribing the authorities to let them get further ahead in the queue. And my grandmother, it came to the stage where they said, you can't go on this train, to us, Kurten Lotte Landskroner. And my grandmother said, "I'll lie down in front of the train. My children, grandchildren, don't go on this train." And that's what my grandmother was like. She was a tremendously dominant person. So we got to Vienna, and then the train, I remember, just seemed to go on forever and ever. It was very crowded. And there was some excitement, but mainly it was worry about where we were going, what was going to happen to us.
Did you ever see your grandmother again?
No, I never saw my grandmother again. My grandmother was arrested late in 1944 and was sent to Ravensbrück concentration camp, where she died only a couple of weeks after she got there, supposedly of old age. And she was 55 and physically very fit, so we can only, the only documentation we have is a paper. which said died of old age.
Was that your mother's mother?
That was my mother's mother, yes.
And why was she taken to Ravensbrück?
Because she was a communist and still worked for the Communist Party at that time. And her husband, Ernst Clementschitz, my grandfather, he was sent to Buchenwald and didn't know where his wife was. He survived Buchenwald, but that's another story a little bit later on, perhaps. But my grandmother had obviously worked for the movement, the communist movement, workers' movement, and managed to escape capture until 1944.
Did you know whether you would see your mother again when you left her at that station?
No. We hoped, we knew that she was also trying to get a permit to come to England, and but we weren't sure whether she was going to be allowed to do so. And it was only the Pinkerton family who engineered her to come to England, and she came to England, to West Kirby, to the same town where we were, and became a housemaid. I'd like to just talk about my arrival at my home, my new home, Stonehive, Darwin's Green, West Kirby. I was separated from my sister because the Allens took my sister to their home, and I walked into Stonehive, and to my new family, my new home, my new family. And I can only say that I was so lucky. There was Dr. Pinkerton, a very tall man with a kindly face. There was Mrs. Pinkerton, whom was a very jolly and caring person, whom I called Auntie, because I couldn't pronounce the word aunt at that stage, and I called her Auntie forever after that. There were two girls, Leslie, 2 years older than me, who mothered me, another girl, Jane, 2 years younger than me. They both instantly, there was instant friendship between us. And I can't describe how kind and friendly and good this family were to me. So once again, I grew up in a happy childhood with that brief interruption that we had before. I was very lucky.
What background was the doctor and his wife? What religion were they?
They were atheists. They were Labour voters, which doctors dominantly were in those days, and they were atheists. But they did take me to the nearest synagogue was in Birkenhead, and they did take me two or three times. It's quite a long way to go. And then asked me whether I wanted to continue to go, and I said no. So from then on, really, I become a non-believer.
Did you speak English when you first came?
No, I didn't speak a word of English. And the Pinkerton family sent me straight away, within a week, to Caldergrange Grammar School, where there was one, funnily enough, a French master who spoke German and nobody else. And I think because of that, I learned English very quickly. And most people say I haven't got an accent or much of an accent if I have. Whereas my sister, who had German-speaking people around her, Dr. Allen, Mrs. Allen spoke German, she always had an accent. Not a very dominant one, but she had one. So, as I say, my childhood is happy. The war broke out, and Austrians, because of the Anschluss, were declared enemy aliens and weren't allowed to live within 50 miles of the coast. So my mother had to go to Birmingham. And at that stage, the Allen family wanted to adopt my sister Lottie legally as their child, and my mother couldn't agree to that because that was not what the arrangement had been in the beginning.
Was your mother still in Austria, or was she?
No, she was in England working as a housemaid.
When did she arrive?
She arrived, I think, the month before the war started, August 39, probably.
Did you see much of your sister when you first arrived?
Quite a bit, yes. She went to a different school, and I mean, she was with a different family, but we did see each other, and we saw Mother, obviously, when she arrived. But as I said, the family wanted to adopt her, and my mother took my sister to Birmingham. And that's a stage where my sister's life and mine parted completely. I was happy. She went, lost her friends in her second home in England that she had, was moved to a third home in Birmingham, and then to others, school to school. Was never a happy person. She went back with my mother to Austria after the war. And again, she was a very attractive woman, and she made friends easily, mostly men friends, but none of these relationships ever worked out. And I think I can just tell you quickly about the story then. She answered a classified advert in the Vienna Courier.
When was that?
That was in, now it's a bit difficult for me to date this. It was probably 1953, around about that time. And it was a physician who lived in Ethiopia who was looking for a wife. She contacted his parents, who were still living in Vienna, and after correspondence with this doctor in Ethiopia, she went to Ethiopia and found out that this was a Nazi Jew hater. And there was this position of, she was in the position of being there with this horrible person. After trials and tribulations, she came back to Austria, and a friend asked her to contact Wiesenthal, Simon Wiesenthal, which she did. And Simon Wiesenthal, I can't go through the whole story now because it takes too long, but Simon Wiesenthal actually knew Dr. Barber personally, because in his days in concentration camps, he had met him. And he hunted him down, and Dr. Barber finally shot himself in a pool full of crocodiles, and the crocodiles didn't eat him. He was found by an American tourist. But I think that the story of my sister is quite unbelievable. She later came back to Austria. She had come back to Austria and then had various jobs. And at the age of 48, she decided to have a beauty operation. And against my mother's will, and she died. She never recovered from the operation. So she really didn't have a very happy life.
If we can go back to you during the war, what was happening to you during the war years here?
Well, I was in Caldergrange Grammar School, excuse me, for 5 years. My uncle and aunt had a cottage in North Wales. I'd been a city boy, brought up in a city, not used to animals. So we used to go for these weekends and then in the summer, the whole summer holidays. And suddenly farming attracted me. And that was so strange to everybody who knew me, because I used to be frightened of dogs and anything. And over the years of holidays there, I decided I wanted to become a farmer.
This aunt and uncle, how were they related to you? Were they blood relations?
No, they weren't. There was Dr. Pinkerton and Mrs. Pinkerton, whose home I went into. And they are my second family, and they are or were uncle and aunt to me. I mean, they're both dead now.
What were their names?
Uncle Pinkerton, Dr. Pinkerton, and Mrs. Pinkerton, Frances Pinkerton. And the two girls, who are still alive and living in the UK, I still regard them as part of my family, even now. So my interest in farming grew, and I call him uncle, so we know that he's Dr. Pinkerton, said, you're not going to go into farming, you ought to study something, and be a doctor or engineer, etc. And I said, no, I want to be a farmer. So he said, okay, and he put me onto a Welsh hill sheep farm for a year, living in, thinking that that would settle any ambition that I had to be a farmer. But it didn't.
How old were you at that point?
I must have been 17 at that point. He then said, well, if you're going to be a farmer, you're going to study and go to university. I had to get my matriculation, so I went to Birmingham. I worked on a farm again. I worked on cannabis farms in the Lickey Hills near Birmingham, and went to Birmingham University Night School and took my matriculation. I was then accepted by Bangor University, where I had three marvelous years, and finished up with a degree in agriculture. I applied to the Colonial Service for a job because my other ambition in life had been to go and see Africa. It was also a great ambition. And I joined the Colonial Office. I asked to join the Colonial Office. I couldn't because I wasn't naturalized. And because I wasn't 21, and my parents weren't being naturalized, I couldn't be naturalized. So I waited. I had to work on the farm in Birmingham and then became naturalized. And then I was accepted by the Colonial Service.
We need to stop now because we've come to the end of the first tape.
Okay.
This is tape number two. I'm conducting an interview with Kurt Landskroner, and it's the 23rd of August. At the end of the last tape, you were talking about joining the Colonial Service, but before you sort of go on to that, how much of your mother were you seeing and what was happening to her at this point?
At that point, during university days, my mother was in Birmingham, as I said before. And, of course, school holidays, I did go and see my mother. My mother was working for the war effort. She'd had various jobs, machine operator, etc., but finished up working for a firm called Baxter's Nuts and Bolts in Birmingham, where she became a great leader to the other ladies, making them work harder. They didn't always appreciate it. And I particularly remember one little stories when I came to visit her in Birmingham. She was cooking my favorite, which is a Wiener Schnitzel, and she burnt herself. And she came out with a stream of four-letter words, which I can't repeat here. I was completely shocked. So I said to her, do you know what you're saying? And she said, all the girls in the factory to say it. So I thought there was no answer to that. I couldn't. So my mother lived in a house in Birmingham which housed the Free Austrian Movement. They formed a movement called the Free Austrian Movement. And they were mostly Jewish people, but not all Jewish people. And my mother met a man younger than herself called Ignaz Blum, who'd been expelled from Austria, went to Buchenwald, just quickly, before the war, and there was an amnesty on Hitler's birthday. Anybody who had the same birthday was freed. So he was freed from Buchenwald and came to England. So he had a really lucky escape. So when they went back to Austria, my mother and Natzel Blum got married.
What year did they go back?
1946, and they got married, and my mother started various businesses, and finished up by having a shop in Vienna called Exotique, which sold goods from all over the world, basically. imported goods such as jewellery, semi-precious jewellery, and cushions, cloths, whatever. And just an aside, my wife is now doing the same thing here, only on a part-time basis. We also have a business called Exotique, after her name, because we import from all over the world because of my travels in the world. So she then carried on living in Austria, bought herself a beautiful house in the Hinterbrühl, just outside Vienna. And everything was going fine until her husband left her for a younger woman. Then my sister died, and she was then completely alone in the Hinterbrühl.
When did your sister go back to Austria?
The same time as that, with my mother.
And how old was your sister at that point?
Difficult now. Had the years up. 26, 27. And
What had happened to her while she was in England? What sort of education had she?
She'd gone to the local school in West Kirby, and then the same thing in Birmingham. And didn't do very well educationally either. Neither of us were very bright at school. She, as I told you, was quite an unhappy person. She went, as she left school in Austria, she became a model for the time being. That didn't work out, and then she had various jobs in an insurance office, etc. So,
did she have any special interests or anything she particularly enjoyed?
Boyfriends, I think. No. And she also became part of the communist movement, because all my family that went back to Austria became part of the communist movement. And again, a little anecdote. Later on in life, when I went with my wife to Vienna for a holiday, it was the workers' day, and there was a parade, and we all went to the town hall. My mother wanted me to put on a communist badge, you know, and I wouldn't. And we stood outside the town hall watching the various movements going past, and suddenly the communist movement arrived. And we watched them going past, and suddenly I saw my mother, and they kept on coming, and I thought, gosh, there's a lot of communists. Then I saw my mother again, and they were walking around running around the town hall and joining the queue again. Because after the war, Austria was poised towards communism. It was a very close decision at the end of the war. So that's a little anecdote that I sort of remember about that time. But going back to my career, joining the Colonial Office meant that I had to go to Cambridge. I did a year in Cambridge, postgraduate diploma course, where I met a lot of colleagues who were later on to go to the colonies with me. Cambridge was a marvellous time in my life. I had already met my wife-to-be.
Where did you meet her?
I met her in West Kirby, back in my home, my second hometown. I met her at dance in a parish hall. And I met a couple of girls at the dance, and I asked one of them if I could take her home. And then later I met Lorna and asked her if I could take her home. It turned out they were both friends, so I took them both home. But anyway, that's how I met Lorna.
And what attracted you to her?
Her father's ham. he was a grocer. And
you already knew him, did you?
No, I didn't know him, but when I started going out with Lorna, his ham was marvellous. But no, she was very pretty, attractive. It was like, I've known her for 50 years, and we've been married 44 years. So there must have been something there that worked. So in going back to Cambridge, I had a very good time there, and the May balls came, to which I invited Lorna. And it was a great year. And after that year, we went to Trinidad to do postgraduate work again in tropical agriculture.
Did Lorna go with you?
No, Lorna didn't go with me. I think we were engaged by then, but I'm not quite sure. No, we weren't engaged. Comes later. No, I went to Trinidad, where again, it was very, very interesting. The studying was interesting. We were a mixture of people, coloured people from all over the world. It's really the first time I got to know people of other racial interests and other colours, etc. And it wasn't just all study. I became captain of rugby there, and we had a rugby team, and I got my first international cap playing against British Guiana. It's not a very great event, but for me it was. So that was the year, and after that year, we were all given a posting. You didn't know where you were going to go. You could have gone anywhere, Asia, East Africa, whatever. By coincidence, two of my best friends at the college were two Ghanaians, Gold Coast boys. And I got to know them very well, and to my surprise, myself and my two other best friends were all posted to the Gold Coast. I was in the Gold Coast for 11 and a half years.
So how old were you when you finished in Trinidad?
I've got to work that out again. 1951, 27 to 51. There you have it. Yeah. And we all got out to... got so many impressions. We went out by boat, the Golfita from Liverpool, and we arrived in Accra. We were taken to the head office, and they produced three boys, as they're called, servants in those days. And my two friends chose the first two and left me with the third one, who was very small, with huge tribal marks. Looked terrible. I thought, what have I got now? Bought a new car and set off for a 850-mile journey up north to the station that I was posted to. And that boy, Atiya Farafura, was with me for 11 and a half years. He saw me off on the boat when I left the country.
So when did you get married?
Got married, I got engaged in the first leave and got married in 1954.
And where did the wedding take place?
The wedding was in West Kirby, where both our families were, basically. And Lorna came out with me.
Did your mother go to your wedding?
No, she wasn't. She was a communist and couldn't get a visa.
And what about your sister?
No, my sister didn't come either. I missed, my mother wasn't at my wedding and she wasn't at my degree ceremony either, which is something, you know, one misses, obviously. Lorna and I arrived in Takoradi, the harbour of Ghana then, and we stayed in a rest house. And we had a meal in the rest house. Then the rest house had a little restaurant with it. And we went to go to bed, and Lorna was getting undressed, etc. And the stream of safari ants came through the door. This is a column of ants about a foot wide and marched in through the door. Lorna screamed. I said, jump into bed and switch the lights. We switched the light out. It wasn't a light, it was a tilly lamp in those days. She said, I can't switch the light out in this darkness. Anyway, because that's the only thing to do. They go on their way wherever they want to go to, which is what happened. But Lorna sat up the whole night in this bed, and the next morning said, I'm waiting for the next boat home. But she persevered and stayed with me for the rest of that time.
Had she worked before she went out to the colonies with you?
She'd worked as such. She obtained her LRM, the licensure at the Royal Academy of Music, and she taught, but in her own house as such. She taught quite a lot of children, yes, but that was...
That was in England?
That was in England, yes. And then, of course, with me, she just looked after me out in Africa. We were lucky that I was on a station. Usually you go out as a probationary officer and you get moved around from pillar to post. But in my case, I was allowed to stay for the first whole tour in the station, and I was went back for another tour, and after that tour, tours were 18 months at a time, and after another tour, the head office wanted to move me to a different station, but the local chief said no, we're fed up with having different agricultural officers. So I stayed there for 7.5 years.
And what sort of work did you do while you were there?
Well, I was running a district, three districts, and together they were probably the size of the whole of Wales. I had an agricultural station, which was a research station and seed producing centre. We had cattle on the station. We were teaching people how to breed cattle that would be work animals, how to plough with them. We were one of my main things was I had three or four nurseries producing mango trees. The dry season in the north of Ghana lasts for 5 months and there's nothing. There's no shade, there's no fruit, nothing. And I produced literally millions of mango trees. And each village, each house planted a mango tree. Any school that was built, primary schools, I planted an avenue of mango trees. And got the nickname of Mango Chutney Landskroner at one stage. But I went back at some later stage, and it's beautiful. These mango trees provide perfect shade. You can sit under them. And, of course, in the dry season, you've got the fruit as well. We introduced dry season gardening as well, which was vegetable production, etc. But my main effort really was I was introduced rice production into the Northern Territories. And we were the first producers of rice. We did it on a simple bunding system. We brought in massive Ferguson tractors. And rice production has become a major thing. And later on in my career, I became a rice expert. From Babli, I was moved and I became Assistant Director of Agriculture in Pevi, Togoland, which was used to be German Togoland. And we stayed there for about 18 months. And it was during that time our first child was conceived. And in those days, there were very few medical facilities, so Lorna went home and had Jill, my first daughter, at home.
And you were still in?
I had to stay, yes, couldn't get leave. And the same thing happened. No, they didn't, sorry, I was correcting myself. When Mark was born, I was on leave.
So did she go back to you with the baby?
Yes, yes.
How old was she when you first saw her?
The baby? Oh, 2 months, I think. But Mark, I was there at the birth itself. They were both in the same hospital in West Kirby. Then in my career, I then became Assistant Director of Agriculture of the Shanti, which is a major region of Ghana. And that continued until independence. After independence, European expatriate officers weren't allowed to be in the top posts, but they wanted me to stay. So they created a post as Principal Scientific Officer of Agronomy. So I stayed for another 2 years, and I was the third last officer of the Clone Service to leave Ghana.
What year?
In 1963.
Did your children go to school there?
No, they were still
too young.
Quite young. They didn't go to school there. I came home. One of my friends, who had also come to Ghana with me, persuaded me, against Lorna's will, to become a farmer, to buy a farm, because singly we couldn't do it, but together we could. So that begins the next phase of my life, really.
What did Lorna want you to do?
Well, she certainly had visions of farming, and she'd seen enough of Africa and the farm there that she knew that's one thing she didn't want to be. She dreamt of having a modern house and living in a town somewhere. She couldn't really see herself living in the country. But, as you probably can see, we're very happy here. And although it isn't a modern house, we're still happy. So we came home, and we managed to, after a lot of tribulations, managed to buy this farm.
What year was that?
That was we came home 1964. And I remember going to the bank manager's office to sign the final papers. And he opened the sherry cabinet and gave us each a glass of sherry. He said, cheers. He said, but remember now, you own nothing. We own it all. I thought, how true. And we carried on farming here. It was tremendously hard work. My partner really didn't like the thing in the end. And finally left, but still left as a partner. He went to Canada.
When you first started farming here, what were you farming?
When we first started farming here, we to get immediate money, we started a poultry unit, which was awful. It was intensive poultry. I scrubbed the eggs every morning and et cetera, et cetera. And the rest of the farm was arable. But later on, we went into barley beef, and we did it extremely well. We were the MLC, the Meat and Livestock Corporation. We were the top producer in the country. And I did a television program for Southern Television on beef rearing, and I've given lectures for Silcox, a big feed producing firm all over the country. And our beef unit was quite famous, but things changed. The price of barley went up, the price of cows went up, and it became completely uneconomical. And there's no barley beef production in this country anymore. So we then, and the other thing that happened was that I had received a call from UNDP asking me if I was Mr. Landskroner, the rice expert. And I thought, nobody's ever called me that before. But Lorna said to me, if they call you a rice expert, that's what you are. And they asked me to go to West Irion. I hadn't got a clue what or where West Irion was. It was Dutch New Guinea, which had been taken over by the Indonesians and was now called West Irion. And I went on my first mission to look at the rice production scheme there. The Dutch, when they left, destroyed everything.
What year was that?
First agricultural, and I'd have to look that up. May I? I've been to over 30 countries, so it's 1969. It's called the Rehabilitation Study of the Kumbi Rice Scheme, UNDP. That's the United Nations Development Programme. And from then on, I worked for many organisations, mainly Hunting Technical Services, who are a firm that did a tremendous amount of work abroad. And later on, a lot for the World Bank, for FAO, for an organization called IFAD, which is the International Fund for Agricultural Development. It's an offshoot of the World Bank based in Rome, but it deals with the poorest of the poor farmers. In other words, there are no large rice schemes, there are no plantations. It's cropping for the small farmer. So I've had a very interesting career, which unfortunately has stopped now. I still feel I could be contributing, but none of these organisations will employ somebody of my age.
What's happening on the farm?
On the farm, I'm doing something called share farming, which basically means that I'm providing the land, all the inputs, seed, fertiliser, etc. And my share farming partner is the contractor who does all the work. The reason for this was first that I had a heart attack some stage, I can't remember quite when, but 6 years ago I had problems with my heart and I've had a quadruple bypass, etc., etc. And then a month later I had a problem and I died 9 times. It sounds very dramatic, but it's true. My wife and daughter came out to the hospital on the 1st of September, our wedding anniversary, and the consultant said, look, we've got to switch this machine off. Other people need it. He's certainly not going to recover, and if he does, he's completely brain dead. Well, don't know whether I heard him or not, but I recovered the following morning, and within 6 days was home. I might be a little brain dead, I don't know. So, because of that, and the subsequent thing, which was a potassium deficiency, that's why I also eat bananas every day. I came back into farming, but I thought physically I can't do as much as I did before. Although about now, 5.5 years later, I'm virtually doing everything. But I certainly don't lift bags of fertilizer anymore. And that's where the share farming came in. And it's been very successful, except there are frustrations at times when you're waiting for the equipment to arrive, you know, when the weather's right. But that can't be helped in the long run.
Going back to sort of more of your personal life, when you came back to live in England, how old were your children at that point?
The children when we came to the farm were 5 and 3. And it was quite hard in those days. There wasn't much money around. We scratched around, and Lorna had to take the children in one battered little car to school. But we've worked on the place, and it's become a really nice little place to live. My son, from a very, very early age, Mark, had developed an interest in geology and in trees. He planted trees, the trees outside, which we'll have a look at later. He bought us seedlings from the Daily Telegraph, 6 inches high, and now beautiful trees. Planted trees everywhere. He went to university.
Which university did he go to?
He started in Brighton College as a student, and then went to Queen Mary's College, London, University of London.
And what did he study there?
He studied earth science there. He won the City of London Draper's Prize for Geography 2 years running, and he got a first class honours degree when he graduated. He then couldn't get a job, of course. He had 140 odd job applications before he found a job, which was with Rural Planning Services in Didcot. And he was there probably for 3.5 years. The company was very small then. It's been built up, was built up then, and now is a multi-million pound business because environmental firms are very important. Unfortunately, he died at the age of 27 years old of asthma. It was completely out of the blue. He'd been with us at the weekend, because he still came home to do the garden, and went to work on the Monday night, on the Monday, and came home Monday night, and his colleague phoned him in the evening to ask about something. And that night we got a policeman knocking on the door, telling us he was dead. So
was he asthmatic?
He had had a small go of asthma at the age of 5, 6, 7, but nothing had happened then. It's not one has to be careful about asthma. It's not, we do a lot of charity work for asthma. We've collected a lot of money since Mark died. One mustn't frighten people. The sudden death syndrome is a rare thing. It means basically fluid builds up and you die of a heart attack. It's not a very common thing. He had done a lot of work for this firm. He covered all sorts of fields outside his subjects as well. And the bosses of the firm always said, if you want to know anything, we'll go to Mark. And as a result of his work there, and only 3.5 years, they've awarded a prize of £1,000 to his college, Queen Mary's College, for the best environmental subject each year. And the committee who chooses a student is made up of the head of the firm, RPS, still his tutor, who was his tutor at the time we were studying there, and the professor of the department, and myself and my wife. And so we have this monumental task each year, with pride, because we feel that his life hasn't been wasted. That they pre-select the students, because there were 90 applicants last year. They pre-select 6 students, they send us the reports, which we try and understand, because they're all scientific subjects. And they're then... Sorry.
We have to stop, but we will pick it up again at the beginning of the next tape. Thanks. Kurt Landskroner, and it's the 23rd of August 1998. You were talking about your son and the 6 students that you had to
choose from. We then go to London University and interview each of those students for 15 minutes, and at the end of that time we decide on the winner, which is not very easy. But in the end I devised a system that we all, because you could talk about it for hours, so we all devised a system. We talked a little bit about it, and then we all put them down in the order 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the lowest number wins. But we have, we're in the 10th year now, the books are over there that the students produce, and we've had 3 years where we've split the prize. But mostly I personally like it to go to one person. But it's a very handsome prize, even these days, £1,000. The student that's selected on that day gets £500 to do his studies, and the previous student gets the other £500 on the completed work that he's produced. So, for us, it is an emotional moment, but it's also, we feel that something has been achieved and it's well worthwhile, and certainly the university have written to us several times, and spoken to us, because we go there quite a bit, saying that the standard of work, because of this prize, has gone up quite considerably, which is very pleasing to know. And, for instance, recently we were in Hong Kong, and a girl, I can't remember the name, who won the prize 2 years ago, we met her parents. He's one of the chief engineers of Hong Kong Harbour. And he'd never met us, and he said how impressed he was with his daughter. The difference, he said, that he made to his daughter's life to have won this prize was tremendous. She became more confident, she'd got a good job. So, you know, it's very rewarding. My daughter, Jill, went to a college of art, and finally, when she came out, graduated, she got a job with Richard Branson. Richard Branson had something called The Barge. It was a recording studio. Richard Branson in those days lived in a barge on the canal, and this barge called The Barge Studios was anchored next door. And she became what is the first lady sound engineer, basically. And she had a very happy year there, learned an awful lot, did a lot of programs. She did a lot of the Capital Radio plays. She did a magazine. She did all the pictorial stuff. She met a lot of famous artists doing voiceovers on various things. and really enjoyed her work there. Richard Branson, for some reason or other, decided that either the barge wasn't making enough money or he didn't want it anymore, and he, at instant notice, said, it's finished. Jill was snapped up straight away by a firm called Saunders & Gordon, who were one of the main advertising firms now in London. And she stayed a sound engineer with them for 3 years, going through all the latest technology. You know, in those days, sound only, then it became sound and vision connected together. And but gave up that career to have children, and is still having children. She's having a baby again in November.
When did she get married?
Always asking me difficult questions. she 10 years ago. Yes, 10 years ago, because they're coming to the 10th wedding anniversary. And we, as I say, they've got two children.
What are their names?
Little granddaughter, Bethany, grandson Jordan, and unknown in November. And I took them all on a skiing holiday last year. First time, they all loved it, including Jordan. And we said we'd go back straight away. So we did early bookings. So we actually booked to go skiing in January next year. And my wife and myself, Lorna, thought, well, we'll have time now to do what we like. We'll go and see the other valleys and et cetera. But now we'll be pulling a little baby around on a sledge, I think. So I'm very happy with my family. I've mentioned that they're called Landskroner. And the reason for that is that my son-in-law, shortly before the wedding, announced that he would like to change his name to Landskroner. And at first, I was taken aback. I didn't know whether this was the right thing or not. And Jill, my daughter, came to me and said, Daddy, any child that I have is half Landskroner blood, whichever way, because I'm a Landskroner, which is true. I mean, in Ghana, it's matriarchal succession, you know. So he changed his name to Landskroner, and he was actually married as Stephen Landskroner. He comes from a big family, 5 boys and a girl.
Why did he decide to do that?
I think he decided that the Landskroner family should go on, which it wouldn't do unless he became a Landskroner. So we now have 3 more Landskroners. We don't know any Landskroners. We have researched and tried to find other Landskroners. There must be some somewhere, but so far we haven't been successful. So,
before we finish, is there anything else you want to add? You know, anything that you might have thought about that you hadn't said earlier?
I've mentioned my sister, and what a coincidence it was that she was to go and marry a Nazi war criminal. But another big coincidence in our lives is my two uncles both went to the Spanish Civil War, and the younger uncle, Ernst, was killed behind lines. He was doing, if anyone has seen the film For Whom the Bridge Tolls, it's exactly the same story. He was blowing up bridges behind enemy lines, and they were surrounded and shot to the last man. My uncle, Eric, survived the war, but was kicked out of Spain, escaped into France, and in France they were put into a concentration camp in France called Kurs, K-U-R-S. But the Austrian government made appeals, and he was then sent to England. But as in England he was then an enemy alien, he was sent to a camp in Canada. When, by the time he got to the camp in Canada, they realized he'd been fighting the Germans longer than most, you know. So they brought him back, and he finally joined the BLA, British Liberation Army, and went over with Montgomery into Germany and France. Whilst he was there, he learned that the Americans had liberated Buchenwald concentration camp. He knew that his father was in the camp, or had been sent to the camp. So he asked for leave, and the commanding officer said, "I can't do that." And he asked for a truck. "He can't do that." But he met a padre who was being sent by the British regiment to the Americans at Buchenwald, and between them they managed to commandeer a lorry or a truck, and they drove to the camp. Excuse me. And he went into the camp and went to the Austrian section, and there he found his grandfather. And the story goes, he says to him, "Don't you know who I am?" And in German, grandfather said, "Bist du mein Bruder?" Are you my son? And that, again, is a remarkable story. The reason political prisoners in Buchenwald were kept on a different basis than the Jewish people, but they also were involved, of course, in most of the nasty jobs at that time. Buchenwald, I've just discovered a letter written by my uncle, which I'm trying to decipher because it was written on paper, in pencil on paper, of his impressions of Buchenwald. And the few things I've read, I mean, we know it was horrific, but it's even worse than I could possibly have imagined. So I wanted to sort of tell that story because it's another coincidence. And the final thing I think I'd like to say is I'm pleased to be doing this because it's caused me to look at all my mother's records, all my uncle's records, all my own things, and I feel at least, or at last, we've got the story of the family together, which I think is important. I think that's really it.
Have you been back to Vienna many times?
I go back to Vienna twice a year, because, not to Vienna itself, but to the Hinterbrühl, where my mother lived. The reason is that my mother still has some financial interest in Vienna, and it can't be done by telephone or whatever. So I'm lucky that I go twice a year. I stay in the Hinterbrühl, sometimes into Vienna, not very often. And whilst I love it, I love the country, it's beautiful, I love the food, it's beautiful, and the beer's not bad, but I wouldn't live there. England is my home. I always say I changed Austria for England. I went to live 12 years in Africa, and then I've had 35 years on the farm here, and this is where I'll be.
Is there a message that you'd like to leave for future generations?
I think if I leave a message, it's a rather negative one. I feel that we haven't learned anything, which is terribly sad. Civilization, knowledge, is supposed to be moving on, and it's not. History is repeating itself, which is terribly sad. It may not be on the scale of the Holocaust, but nevertheless, women, children, innocent people are being killed. And I think I've joined, not being a Jew anymore, or considering myself not as a Jew, I've joined the Christian-Jewish movement because it is the one organization that's trying to get two religions together to understand each other. And I think if more of that could be done, we might bring about a change. But at the moment, nothing's been learned.
Thank you. Can you tell us about this picture, please?
This is my father, Elias Landskroner. It was taken in Graz, in Austria, and it was probably taken 3 years before the war, 1936.
Okay. Can you tell us about this one, please?
Yes, this is my grandmother, Christine Clementschitz, usually called by everybody Crystal. It was taken again in Graz, Austria. the year is difficult to judge, but probably 1938, something like that.
Right. Would you like to tell us about this one, please?
Yes, this photograph was taken in Graz before the war. In the centre is myself and my sister Lotte. On the right-hand side is Tante Erna, who is my mother's sister. And on the left-hand side is a girlfriend of my uncle Ernst, who went to Spain to the Spanish Civil War.
Do you remember her name?
No.
And did you say when this was taken?
Well, I can only guess that it was 1938. Come on.
Do you know who's in there?
No, that's one's obviously Clemenchid's family with friends. But I.
Can you tell us about this one, please?
Yes, this is a photograph taken shortly or after our arrival in England. It's my mother on the left and my sister Lotte in the middle and myself on the right, and it was taken in 1941.
Would you like to tell us about this one, please?
Yes, the photograph here is taken in Buchenwald after its liberation by the American Army, and the person third from the left is my grandfather. He was one of seven Austrian survivors in the camp.
Can you name your grandfather for us, please?
Grandfather was Ernst Clemenschitz.
And do you know when this was taken?
Well, it was late 44, I would think, because that was after the BLA, and the Americans, as I say, were the first to be at the camp. Yes, this is my uncle Eric Clemenschitz. It was taken after he came back to England from Canada, where he was interned, and was allowed to join the British Army, and had to change his name to Clement, so that he wasn't regarded as a traitor in uniform if he was captured. Yes, this is a ticket that was put around our necks when we left Vienna to travel on the Kinder transport to England. On the back is another number, which is the luggage, which is our luggage number. Yes, this is the other side, and it basically says that the luggage belongs to the children, Janowski, Kreisel, and Landskroner. And it's numbers 123 and 124 are for Landskroner.
Okay.
This is my certificate of registration, which, when the war started, as Austrian Millennium Aliens, we had to report whenever we moved home. And it's a very full book because it was at the time when I was at university, so it was to university and back on leave and back to university. It had to be stamped by the local police each time. Can't sign.
Okay. Tell us about this one.
This is
our wedding photograph, Court and Lorna. It was taken on the 1st of September 1954, and we were off on our honeymoon shortly after. Just a note, just a minute. This one's confusing me. Is Lorna there?
Was it taken here or?
Right.
It was sent to my children's grandparents as it now arrived in England. And
so it was 1963 anyway?
Yes.
When we came
yes.
to the farm, yeah.
That's right.
Okay.
Could you tell us about this one, please?
Yes, this photograph was taken when we first came to the farm in 1963. It was meant to be sent and was sent to their grandparents. It's my two children, and it's Jill and Mark.
Okay. Would you like to tell us about this one, please?
This is a photograph of a tobacco crop that was grown at Home Farm. You can see the farm in the background and myself standing in the field. It was an experiment, basically, with British American tobacco to see if tobacco could be grown successfully in this country. It was grown in this country back in Cromwell's days, and it was considered that as we were importing from far afield, they didn't want people to grow it in this country. They sent troops of horse through the fields to destroy them.
If you'd like to tell us about this one, please.
This is Mark, our son, a lovely boy who was very intelligent and tragically died an early death, but his life still lives on, his memory is still there, and there are many good things happening in his memory. There's a book prize at Brighton College and £1,000 a year prize at Queen Mary's College, London, for the best environmental study.
You know when this was taken? Approximately.
Mm-hmm. Lorna would know. Okay, just a minute. Work it out. 1986. Choose his, borrow his Moss Bros suit for the wedding. And I never made it. We had the wedding, we decided. We all talked about it, we decided we'd go ahead with the wedding, you know, because he would have wanted it.
If you'd like to tell us about this one, please.
This is my daughter's wedding. Proud parents are standing on, looking by, and Stephen, our son-in-law, is looking very glamorous as well. It was a lovely day.
And when was that taken?
No, I have to get Lorna for that. Do you cancel that? It's hopeless.
Can I just ask?
They were married on the 24th of June, 1989.
If you could tell us about this one, please.
This is a photograph of me taken on Home Farm. And it was done during an interview for the local paper because I was leaving for Ethiopia on an IFAD project, which was a seed rehabilitation scheme. And that was in November 1985. I talked about the Kristallnacht when our whole home was destroyed, all the lovely things that my mother had. These two objects, a little silver tray and a cut glass, sherry glass, which was out of a set of glasses, are the only thing that remain, and I treasure these very much. And it also reminds me of the terrible night. Yes, when our son Mark died, we scattered his ashes on the farm because he loved the farm so much. We call this a tribute to Mark. It's not a memorial. And it's my wife thought long and hard of what to do. And we came up with this idea of a ball that shows his whole surroundings. He can see his trees, he can see the house, and we can see it as well. The base of this is made of marble. It's marble from the same quarries of the Taj Mahal. The silver ball came from America, and one can just see a tiny little bronze frog which came from Vienna. And Mark, one of his other great things was his love for frogs. That's fantastic. That's incredible. Gotta have one. Will this be on the video? Hmm. That's fantastic.
Would you like to introduce your family, please?
This is my family, my lovely family. I've got my wife, Lorna, here, sitting next to me. My daughter, Jill. Her husband, Stephen. My two grandchildren, Bethany and Jordan.
If I may ask you, how did you meet your husband?
At a dance.
And did you know immediately that this was the person that you wanted to spend the rest of your life with?
No, I don't think I did. But I'm glad I did.
And how much did your husband tell you of his experiences as a child and during the war?
Very little.
Even to...
Yes, even to this very day, I've learned more since this happened than I've ever known.
Did you discuss your experiences with your children?
Not really, no. I think now that we've made this effort and to get all the information together, we will discuss it. And of course the film itself will be a memo of what's happened.
How much have you picked up from your father's experiences along the way?
I think quite a lot of his war experience, and certainly coming over as a child refugee, but not so much of the history back in the family as to what happened with my great-grandparents, for instance. It's mostly his experience coming over in the war as an 11-year-old, which I was very aware of as a child, but that's really mostly what we know.
Do you think this affected your relationship with your parents or your father in any way?
No, I don't think so. I think he's very together, actually. I don't think it has at all.
And have you discussed your father's history with your children?
Briefly, yes, but they're still quite young at the moment. I mean, I found I asked more questions when I hit my teenage years, and mostly of my grandmother, in actual fact, whose experience was different. And so I got most of my background information from her, but it really came from me wanting to know when I was older. And I think probably when they're older, the same will probably happen.
Has it been interesting for you learning about
your... I've actually learnt more in the last week than I have since I've met these people, you know. Never talked about it before, only the odd snippet here and there. This week has been pretty interesting. Some quite amusing stories as well come out of it. Yeah.
And is there anything you'd like to say about your grandpa and your grandma?
Well, my grandma and grandpa are really kind to me. They help me a lot, and I like them really much.
That's really nice. So what about Jordan, is there anything you'd like to say? No?
Not a few words.
Is there anything else that you would like to add?
No, I don't think so. We've been glad that we've had this opportunity, and I'm glad that my family have come in on the experience as well, because I think it'll be a tremendous record. And I'm pleased also that it will perhaps help some people to understand, and also for people to perhaps, when they're researching, find out more about each other. Some families may get together because of this. We don't know.
Thank you very much, all of you.
Thank you.